good morning, everyone. I am so glad you chose to be in worship today. We clearly have a number of people that are, what's going on in town? Something's going on. But it is a great day to be in the house of the Lord as we celebrate and as we worship on this Lord's Day. We have some special guests with us who I will introduce a little later in the service. And so we're just grateful to be able to share together in this time of celebrating and worshiping our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'd like to invite you to stand as you are able, and we'll join together in the call to worship, which is printed on the front of the bulletin, or you can follow along on the screen. The voice of God created the universe. The voice of God calls us to worship, and we cry, the voice of Christ calls us as sisters and brothers. The voice of Christ calls us to worship, and we cry, glory, glory. The voice of the Spirit claims us as children of God. The voice of the Spirit calls us to worship, and we cry, glory, glory, glory. Let us continue in the celebration of worship as we sing hymn number 698, God of the Ages.
Let us pray. Holy and awesome God, you are too amazing for us to comprehend. We thank you for the majesty, the power, and the glory of your divine presence. We are grateful you came to us in the person of a tiny human baby. You sent your Son to enter fully into our lives. Our connection with Christ continues through the power of your Holy Spirit, the life-giving Spirit that transforms us into brothers and sisters of Christ, full partners in the glory of your divine love. With hearts overflowing, we thank you. Amen and amen. The Lord be with you. Please take a few minutes and pass the peace of Christ to your neighbor.
Once again, it is good to welcome you, and I do want to invite you, if you are at the end of the row, if you'd take those attendance pads and pass those down the row and let us know you're here, and also that gives you an opportunity, if there are things you want to communicate to the pastoral staff, there's a place there to do that. As I normally ask you, I'd like you to turn in your bulletins to the center blue section, which has a lot of our upcoming events and activities. I won't highlight them all, but there are a couple I'll just mention. So you might want to plan ahead and put on your calendars. We'll be having a fellowship event, attending an Indians game together on June 23rd. And so you'll want to plan ahead for that. And on June 9th, the Joyful Sounds Handbell Choir will be here. That's just a couple weeks away. And so that'll be 2:00 in the afternoon. As you can see, there are GROW activities. A lot of our small groups are sort of winding down their spring studies, and there'll be a few that begin during the summer. So summer's always a good time to be a part of a small group. If you haven't done that before, good time to start. And then on the right-hand side of that, there are a number of missional activities. We'll highlight a couple of those during the introduction to the offering, but I do want you to plan ahead for our blood drive on June 23. That you might plan to be here and give the gift of life. All of these are ways that we continue here at St. Mark's to strive to make mission a way of life. And in that vein, I want to say that we have a couple of special guests with us this morning, and I want to take a moment to introduce them. We have Reverend Dr. Anthony Dio and his wife Jennifer. They're sitting here in the front. And so, Dr. Dio is Vice President for Academic Affairs at the United Methodist University of Liberia. The United Methodist University is a private four-year liberal arts institution of higher learning owned by the Liberia Annual Conference of the United Methodist Church and is located in Monrovia, Liberia. The university has about 5,000 students enrolled on four campuses across Liberia. Affiliated with the General Board of Higher Education and Ministry of the United Methodist Church, the university is the only UMC institution of higher learning in the West Africa Central Conference. The vision or goal of the university is to prepare a new generation of men and women schooled on the African continent to build nations that are spiritually, socially, economically, and politically independent and self-sustaining. So I'm going to ask Dr. Dio to come forward and share just a brief moment with us and extend an invitation for us to participate through our financial gifts to the university. And he's also a pastor and father and grandfather, and so he'll share a little bit of that as well. But Dr. Dio, welcome.
Thank you, sir. Good morning. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I want to greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ, and to also bring you greetings from our children, our grandchildren, from the president of the university, our student, faculty, and staff, and from our resident bishop, Bishop Samuel Jerome Quiet, who called this morning and asked us to greet you and say to you that we love you and we appreciate your support and prayer over the years as we serve through Operation Classroom to the different schools in Liberia. I said this morning, I say again, St. Mark's holds a special place for us in our ministry. As my wife and I serve Operation Classroom, we made several trips here, including St. Mark's, and participated in some of your parking parties. And we pray that one of these days, parking parties will come back to St. Mark's for Liberia. also, for full disclosure, I attended school in Liberia and here in the U.S., especially Michigan State University. I understand that. but thank God. I also did CPE here in Indianapolis, and so by the grace of God, the Spartans and others, you know, could still meet and praise God and worship God together. I just want to say a word about the university. United Methodist University lives and depends on tuition and fees for this operation and survival. Regrettably, as a result of the COVID-19, the university was closed down for over 7 months. No student, no faculty, no activity, and we have not been able to recover since that time. And our faculty, staff, including ourselves, have not been paid for several months, 4 months now. And but in spite of the financial difficulty the university is in, we have been able to celebrate some achievements, especially in our sciences program, where we teach nursing and midwifery. And for the past 5 years since I've been at the university, our graduates from the nursing program, Winifred Halleck nursing program, all of our students by 100%, they go to the state board exam and pass 100% for 5 years in succession. We received our accreditation last year, and it was continued up to the next 4 years. And we are hopeful that every year, every time that accreditation expires, we'll go back for a new one and we'll get accredited. Also, our general sciences program, which include biology, chemistry, environmental, and marine sciences, our students are doing well as much. Those who graduate in those programs go to medical school, some go to pharmacy school, and also the top, the school at the top of the exam. And these are things that we celebrate, we praise God for, so this morning, I just want to say again, thank you for all the support that you are giving to Liberia over the years. But specifically, I want to lift up the United Methodist University to put on your prayer list so that the students who come and are not able to pay their fees can receive some form of financial support. It takes $300, for example, for the basic program per semester to educate a student. For those who are in the sciences, the nursing program, it takes between $400 to $500 per semester. So if you wanted to sponsor a student from freshman to senior level at the liberal arts level, you would spend something like $2,400. If you were interested in the sciences, you want to sponsor a science student or ICT student, it will cost between $500 to $600, you know, per semester, which means $4,000 for 4 years, you should be able to sponsor a student. So our prayer is that God will speak to your heart in addition to what you are already doing for Liberia and Sierra Leone to consider sponsoring students through our scholarship program. And I guarantee you, upon the word of St. Paul, that when you, whatever you give, in the name of Christ Jesus, your labor, your gift will not be in vain. And so I want to thank God for you, for everything, and God bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
So I'm going to invite Mrs. Dio to come forward, and I'd just like to say a prayer of blessing for them, and pray for God's spirit as they travel, continue their travels and their work.
Thank you. And while Jennifer is coming, I just wanted to recognize Jackie and Rick Chandler, whom we are known for the past 30 years. They be partners in mission and friends. They have invited us to their home, and we live there as one family. I want to praise God for them as well. Okay. Jennifer and I have been married for 37 years. We have 4 children and many grandchildren.
All right. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, I do thank you for the Dios. I thank you for their travels, which have taken them here. And I pray that you might continue to be with them as they move on and as they travel home. We thank you for their ministry as a pastoral family, and also the Dr. Dio's ministry with the university. And we just pray, oh God, that you might continue to encourage them as they work and witness to all that you have in their lives. And we just surround them with our prayers and your spirit in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God you, bless. Thank you. God bless you. So I do want to say, if you would like to make a donation to the United Methodist University of Liberia, you can use the mission cards, which are in the blue folders, and just mark it Methodist University of Liberia. Or if you, those of you who are watching at home on the live feed, you can go to our website, go to stmarkscarmel.org/give, and then select special offering, and when you do that, there will be a field there, select other, and then write in United Methodist University of Liberia. So thank you again for being here, and thank you for helping us see the ways that the United Methodist Church is extended in ministry throughout the world.
This morning's New Testament lesson is from Romans chapter 8, verses 12 through 17. You can follow along on the screen or in your pew Bibles. It's in the New Testament section on page 158. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness to our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. This is the word of the Lord for the people of, so sort of word of God for the people of God. I was close.
In the morning when I rise. midnight was my cry. Dark midnight was my cry.
Thank you, Eric and Kathy. We have Kathy Heatland playing with us this morning. She's going to be with us for the summer, and so we appreciate you playing as well. At this time, we move into our time of prayers, and I think many or most of you know that we've been doing a breakthrough prayer initiative the last probably about 15 months. And we have a fairly new breakthrough prayer we're going to be using for the summer. And so I'd like for us to pray that prayer together, and then we will have a time of silent prayer, and then I'll lead us in the pastoral prayer. I do want to remind us that while we do think of this Sunday in Indianapolis as race day, primarily it is Memorial Day and a time for us to remember those who have made the ultimate sacrifice so that we might have the freedoms that we enjoy. And so we want to say a particular word of thanks for those who have given their lives to serve our country. At this time, I'd like to invite you to join the breakthrough prayer and then join me in a time of silence. So let us pray. God, open doors to reveal new hopes and dreams. for St. Mark's and in our own lives. Give us the courage to follow where you lead. Amen. Now let us join together in a time of silent prayer. Let us offer our prayers, crying, Abba, Father, knowing that it is God's Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children and heirs of God. Eternal God, we pray for the world, that through the reconciling love of Christ, our destructive and violent ways may cease as you bless your human family with peace. We pray for the mission of your church, that empowered by your Spirit, we may proclaim the good news of the age in the world you so dearly love. We pray for all who suffer, that together with Christ in his suffering, we may find healing as he did, as he was raised and exalted in you. We pray for your creation, that as it groans for its redemption, we may care for its well-being through the power of your life-giving Spirit. We remember before you those who have died and pray for those who will die, that through your glorious redemption that ends all suffering, they may rest with you eternally. Through Christ, with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we praise you, O God, now and forever. And together we lift our voices in the prayer that Christ taught his disciples and us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our mission focus for May is Brightwood Community Center. Despite the chaos in the community and the world at large, the Brightwood Community Center continues to deliver excellent programming while also giving hope to families around Indianapolis. Executive Director Shona Majors emphasized the growth and improvements that the community center has been achieving by saying, "Feel encouraged that things are changing for the better in our community." Contributions for Brightwood may be given online at stmarkscarmel.org/give. Or by using the offering envelope in the blue attendance pads. Also during May, we are collecting specific items to support East 10th's summer camps and children's books to support grassroots projects. East 10th's Children's and Youth Center is an accredited early learning center in East Indianapolis. They offer a variety of programs, including the Early Learning Child Care Center, Summer Days for Youth, and Before and After School program. Grassroots Projects provides support for under-resourced immigrant and refugee children. Their projects provide resources for the children's health, nutrition, clothing, education, and cultural needs. For your convenience, postcards with the QR code for an Amazon wish list are on a table in the gathering area. Children of the church are encouraged to help their parents shop for items so that they learn the importance of giving to those in need. Kids can drop off their donations at check-in for Kids Church. Because you give, St. Mark's gives. Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for creating all the children of the world who live in many lands, have many traditions, and speak many languages. Help us to offer all that we can to remove barriers and empower these children to reach their full potential. In your Son, Jesus' precious name, amen.
I'd like to invite you to remain standing as we hear this morning's gospel lesson, probably one of the most familiar passages in the Bible, which is both a blessing and in some ways a challenge for us to hear it with fresh ears. So let us hear these words. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." And Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" And Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of the water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" And Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. And if I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So this past week, I've been reading a book by the former music director of the Hollywood Bowl Symphony and very well-known conductor. His name is John McCherry. And he wrote a book called Maestros and Their Music, The Art and Alchemy of Conducting, which is probably not a book that everybody would particularly read, but I found it interesting and inspiring. And there's a moment in there where he's talking about interpretation. And I think about passages like this when I think about what he said, because most of us have heard a few sermons on John 3:16. As a matter of fact, I have probably preached a few dozen sermons on John 3:16. And so it's always a challenge to kind of hear it with fresh ears. And in the book, John McCherry tells a story about, he's talking about different interpretations of music and how you make decisions. And he was very much into researching historical scores and doing this. But he said it's sort of like, it's like the novel some of you may have read. It's called Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And he said, you know, Dr. Jekyll, which we know as Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, actually was a Scottish novel, and the proper pronunciation of the first name is Jekyll. There was an early Hollywood movie made with that name, and then, of course, Lon Chaney made a much more famous movie, and the studio made a concerted effort to destroy all the copies of the earlier movie because in that movie they pronounced it Dr. Jekyll. And so after that, in the book, he calls these revelatory moments Dr. Jekyll moments, because they are times when we make some discovery about what is historically accurate and right, but it is so foreign to people's ears that they're not able to accept it. And for most of us, if you went up to someone today and you said, oh, I just read a novel I haven't read before, it's called Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, probably somebody's going to look at you funny. Or chuckle, just like you did. And so when we think about John 3:16, we think, what is there to this that maybe we have, what layer of interpretation have we heard so often that we confuse it for the actual story and the text itself? And that would be unfortunate, because this is actually a very rich story in terms of Jesus, this interaction with Nicodemus and Jesus in the middle of the night. Now, I know that we've talked before about how in the Gospel of John, the darkness and the light metaphor is very important. And in John 3, you have a situation where Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the middle of the night, in the darkness, and he kind of leaves still unenlightened or in the darkness. And then the next day, or in the next chapter, at least in the Gospel of John, in chapter 4, we hear the story of Jesus meeting a Samaritan woman at the well in the brightest time, the most light time of the day, and she accepts Jesus' message and brings her friends to be with him. And so there is an irony here in that the first story tells about someone who should get it and doesn't. And the second story tells us about someone who probably we would say shouldn't get it, or we might exclude, but who gets the message and understands the transforming nature of Jesus' message. So Nicodemus comes in the middle of the night to speak to Jesus, and he says, how can I inherit eternal life? Now, I often would like to have the rest of the story from the gospel writers. We oftentimes don't get that. In this case, by the end of the story, Nicodemus is shaking his head and leaving Jesus, and we wonder what happened next and what happens to this man. We hear about him just a little bit at the end of Jesus' life when he helps Joseph of Arimathea prepare Jesus' body for the grave, but we don't get much more than that. But what Jesus says to him is, you have to be born again. You have to experience new birth. Many of us have participated in or witnessed new birth in our lives, particularly of our children or grandchildren. And I have to say, being a father and a grandparent, it's been one of the biggest thrills of my life. And I remember particularly with my now 7-year-old grandson when he was born. And Michelle and I went to the hospital, and I'm holding this little boy for the first time that we have prayed for and dreamed of, and I whisper into his ears my hope and dream for him as I say to this barely a few hours old infant, I'm going to teach you how to play baseball. Because that's what grandparents do. We get to do the fun things. We get to invest in the activities that we love and desire for them to know. And I have begun teaching him to play baseball. He's 7. And so we invest dreams into people in their new lives. And so when Nicodemus comes to Jesus, he said, You have to start new. You have to start fresh. You have to forget about Dr. Jekyll and look to Dr. Jekyll. You have to think about something in a new way in order for you to experience the new life you desire. Here was a person who thought he got it, but he didn't. And part of that, in order to experience the new birth that Jesus describes, is that he has to let certain things die in his life. In order to do that, we have to decide who God is calling us to be and how we might accommodate that. One of our favorite novels and plays is Les Miserables. And in the musical version of Les Miserables, the main character, Jean Valjean, has a song in which he's wrestling with an ethical conundrum. He has escaped his imprisonment. He has started a new life, but the officer who's about to arrest another person, Javert is the police officer, he's about to arrest another person who he claims to be Jean Valjean. And so Jean Valjean has a choice. Does he make himself known in order to rescue this person, or does he just go on and let it happen and make his escape into freedom? And so he sings a soliloquy in which he shares these words. Can I condemn this man to slavery? Pretend I do not feel his agony, this innocent who bears my face, who goes to judgment in on my place? Who am I? Can I conceal myself forevermore? Pretend I'm not the man I was before? And must my name until I die be no more than an alibi? Must I lie? How can I ever face my fellow men? How can I ever face myself again? My soul belongs to God, I know. I made that bargain long ago. He gave me hope when hope was gone. He gave me strength to journey on. Who am I? Who am I? I am Jean Valjean. And so, Javert, you see, it's true. The man bears no more guilt than you. Who am I? 24601, which is the number, his prison number. And so he wrestles with, can I give up this past? Can I do what's right in God's sight? What is my obligation to who I was and my obligation to who I can become? And so sometimes in order to be the person that we are birthed into, we also have to make peace and maybe die to some of the things that we need to get rid of in order to be resurrected. We need to be born into something new. And so Nicodemus comes to Jesus and he says, how do I do this? And Jesus says, you must be born anew or from above. It could be translated either way. And Nicodemus looks at him with a confused look. And he says, I really don't understand what you want me to do. So we might think of this ironic moment as a form of humor. We think, silly Nicodemus, you should get it. Well, we're looking back on this story 2,000 years later. But as one person has said, irony as a form of humor often contains elements of tragic as well. Whether in lampooning the temple officials or Jesus' own disciples, the fourth gospel's use of irony constantly reminds us of the presence of a creative force that has shaped the narrative for a particular purpose. And so John, in the telling this story, makes Nicodemus seem sort of ironic, but also tragic. And as I said, hopefully that tragedy turns into something a little more productive. And so our question is, what for us does it mean to be born anew? What does it mean to move into new facets of God's life and ministry for us? Last week, we talked a little bit about John Wesley and his Aldersgate experience, that outpouring of God's Spirit. And I'm reminded that John Wesley spent a good part of his early life trying to construct a structure that would make God present in his life. But it wasn't until God's Spirit really poured out upon him that he was able to move into what became the most productive years of his life. I teach a class on early theology with the United Methodist Course of Study, and we end with Augustine. And Augustine's life, as he tells it in his book Confessions, is a story of searching and yearning, but there comes a point in his life where he clearly understands that something has to change, and he clearly understands that the life that he is living is not the life that God wants him to live. And there is a moment in which Augustine says to God, God, I want you to help me change my habits, but not right now. And how many of us reflect that in saying, God, I'm going to do better. I'm going to change. I'm going to go in a new direction, but maybe just a little later. The Apostle Paul, in the passage from Romans that Todd read a few minutes ago, in that he says, so then, brothers and sisters, we are obligated not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. And that is sort of the new life that Jesus is describing, to put to death the deeds of our old life, and to take on the new and fresh expressions of God's faith that God is inviting to in our lives. So I ask you this morning, and I ask myself, what are the places in our lives where God wants us to step out into new life? And I ask that not just as a person of faith and for you as personal individuals, but I ask that as a church and for us as a congregation. What are things that we have to be willing to let go of in order to grasp hold of what God has for our future? I began with a grandfather story, so I'm going to end with a grandfather story. We also have a three-year-old granddaughter, and her informal title in our household is Grandma's Little Helper. And she helps Michelle, and those of you who know my wife Michelle know she's a master gardener. She really likes doing things in the dirt and planting. So she has helped Winry plant seeds in little pots. And so Winry was at our house Friday, And she walked to the pots along the sidewalk and began to kind of take an inventory of which ones had plants coming in up yet and which ones didn't. And I imagine in my mind's eye, God kind of looking down on us and saying, I've planted these plants, I've planted these seeds in people's lives. I wonder which ones will take hold and grow into what I imagined them to be. And so as we think about this passage, this being born anew from above, what does it mean for us to be planted in the rich soil of God's Spirit so that we might grow into that person and into the church that God calls us to be? Let us pray. Almighty and holy God, you have planted seeds in our lives. Sometimes we choose not to grow. And for those times when we ignore or disobey your intention for our lives, we ask for your forgiveness. And we pray, O God, that we might put to death those things that hinder us from being all that you want us to be. And we pray that through the power and presence of your Holy Spirit, we might grow into your people as individuals, as a congregation, and as a world. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn, which is the Hymn of Promise. And now may the Lord give you strength, may the Lord bless you with peace, and the blessing of God who creates, redeems, and restores be with you now and always. Amen.